It is a Victory Monday edition of the Daily Grossi here. Chris Olek, our Browns analyst, Tony Grossi, alongside me. Tone, we will get to the game itself. The Browns getting a big win over the Jacksonville Jaguars on Sunday. But let's start with the news of the day. Head coach Kevin Stefanski spoke with the media earlier today. And a lot of the newsworthy stuff here is all of the injuries. Let's start with right tackle, the rookie, DeJuan Jones, knee injury out for the rest of the year. Your reaction to that?
I'm surprised. I mean, he had been working through a knee injury. I think Stefanski did say this was a different injury that will require surgery, and he is out for the year. The right tackle, rookie right tackle, probably rookie of the year on the Browns. So now you're down to your third right tackle, and that will be James Hudson, who filled in for DeJuan Jones on and off the last couple weeks. So, you know, right now, Ethan Posick didn't finish the game. And so you had a backup center in there. You have a backup left tackle there. So you have six. Other than the two guards, everybody else is second or third team at this point. That's the way it's happening all over the league, Chris. It's survival of the fittest. And teams, even the teams in the playoff hunt, virtually limp to the finish line from this point. And the Browns, Wyatt Teller said, I said, can you survive a third right tackle? He said, we'll do better than survive. I think the strength always of this line is its line coach and getting next man up to speed. So it's unfortunate for DeJuan Jones, who's having a great rookie season, but you know, the season does not wait for things like this.
Right. I remember earlier this year we asked Callahan to be a miracle worker. Well, he's got his work cut out for him again. On that note, now with the offensive line, what is the status of Jedrick Wills?
Well, he has not been designated for return just yet. I think he's entering the fifth week of his injury. Maybe it is the sixth week. Once they designate him to return, that means he practices and then has a chance to get back on the field. But there was actually no mention of Jed in today's Zoom call with the coach. But they have yet to activate that three-week window to get him back on the field.
Yeah, because they're going to need as many bodies on that offensive line as they can.
So he should be back before the year's over, though. So if not this week, shortly thereafter.
Juan Thornhill, he re-aggravated his calf injury in pregame warm-up. So I know the calf injuries can linger, but that one was disappointing, finding out an hour or so before the game.
Yeah, as you said, calf injuries can be 4 to 6 weeks sometimes. He's been on and off the field since he had his. We'll see Wednesday if he gets back to practice. A couple of weeks ago, they signed a veteran safety to their practice squad named Duren Harmon. And coach was asked about him today. And if need be, they'll get him up. But so far, they haven't had to activate him from the practice squad. And Thornhill's status is to be determined during the course of the week.
Yeah, well, elsewhere in the secondary, they're beat up. Denzel Ward did not play. He was not active yesterday against Jacksonville. A bit of a surprise. Were you surprised that he wasn't active?
I was, because we had talked to Denzel. He was hopeful and sounded like he was raring to go. He did practice. The coach said there was no setback in any of those practices. It was just decided that he needed another week. So look forward to seeing him back on the field Wednesday.
I think the most concerning out of all of these, not DeJuan Jones aside, Grant Delpit, a groin injury. Kevin Stefanski was a little less clear of the direction with him. As we know, the Browns actually just made it official moments ago as we're recording this of the contract extension for Grant Delpit. But that could be a big loss for the Browns secondary.
Yeah, the severity has yet to be determined. And the coach said they're still gathering results, which was a little ominous. But yes, so far, nothing definitive on how long Delpit. That was a groin injury. And it, you know, originally it looked like he got hurt on the, he collided with Myles Garrett in the backfield on the pressure of the quarterback. But apparently it happened prior to the collision, but on that play. And groin injuries can be non-contact. And I think that's what happened, a misstep, and all of a sudden some pain in the groin area. And then he finished the play colliding with Garrett. But no real update, but that doesn't sound like great news. Well, hopefully
right, no. Yeah, no, it does not. Just the last one here from an injury standpoint, Jerome Ford. All things appear to be okay. Stefanski said that he's good. He suffered an arm injury yesterday in that game, but because again, they're gonna need the running backs.
Yeah, he didn't even mention him in his rundown of the injuries, and he made a note of that. I didn't even mention him, right? He's good. He'll be good.
Yeah.
So that's good news.
All right. Well, the Browns did get the win yesterday, Tony, 31-27. We'll dive into it in just a sec, but first a word from our friends over at BetMGM.
New customers at BetMGM, now's the time to enjoy all your favorite sports like never before at BetMGM. You can sign up, use the code GROSSI, receive up to $1,500 back in bonus bets if you don't win your first bet. When you register with BetMGM, you'll get instant access to a variety of parlay selection features, player props, and the very best daily promotions in the business. With BetMGM at your fingertips, every play and every game matter more than ever. Must be 21 and up and present in Ohio. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-GAMBLER in partnership with MGM Northfield Park.
Well, Tony, you had Flacco fever before the game. I'm imagining your symptoms have only have become more severe. Joe Flacco yesterday, 26 of 45, 311 yards, three touchdowns, one interception, was sacked just once. But, Tony, I don't know if anyone ever expected Joe Flacco in two games to look as good as he has.
You know, Chris, I was the biggest Flacco fan, or the biggest fan of this move when they brought him in. I did think he immediately was the best quarterback on hand, but I didn't expect the production that we've seen, the efficiency. In two games, his completion percentage is about 55%. But you have to take into account, there's probably at least 10 throwaways there, which were not negative plays at all, but positive plays. So don't expect Flacco to be a 66% thrower. His passes are deeper than the norm. And I think he's surprised me. I asked Wyatt Teller today, be honest, has he surprised you? And he said yes and no. You know, I didn't want to say it's been a total shock.
Right.
But you could tell. Small sample size, but man, it's nothing but encouraging. And I made the point with the coach, and I'm going to expand on this. Everybody in the league is beaten down in week 14 now. Mm-hmm. Everybody who's been playing, quarterbacks included. And here's a guy who's played two games. He's not beaten down. He's completely vibrant and energetic, even for a 38, soon to be 39-year-old. I think that gives the Browns a bit of an edge at that position. I mean, even the quarterbacks who have not missed a game, well, especially the ones who have not missed a game, those sacks add up. They take their toll, the hits, the practices, and you got a really fresh quarterback now lining up for the last four games. I think that bodes well for what lies ahead.
Yeah. And Tone, I mean, he's done a great job of distributing. He hit eight different receivers yesterday, and he's making these guys better. Njoku yesterday, two touchdowns. Elijah Moore appears to be a different receiver. David Bell making plays. Cedric Tillman making plays. So it seems like the Browns kind of stumbled into him.
Oh, absolutely. They did. He's the perfect guy at the perfect time with his experience, his poise, his leadership. He's always been, you know, icy cool. That's going to help them in these tough games, you know, on the road especially. Nothing can faze him. He's always been unflappable. But I think my biggest surprise, Chris, is his arm strength is like in his mid-20s.
Yeah.
As still strong as ever. And his ability to execute, you know, the play fake. I forgot what a good play faker he was. Maybe Baltimore didn't do it as much as we're seeing it here.
Sure.
But he's been he's got big hands, so he can handle the ball very well. So again, I just think that what we're seeing at quarterback at this stage of the season is nothing but a positive, man. It's very it just gives you the enthusiasm for this season to go on from here.
And defensively, Tony, the Browns were able to make some plays. They're able to finally get some turnovers. They forced three interceptions. MJ Emerson, what a day he had. And I thought Greg Newsom also stepped up in the absence of Denzel Ward.
Yeah, you know, Jacksonville had a pretty good third down percentage against the Browns. That has been the Browns' like calling card all year. They were under 30%, and I think Jacksonville was 7 out of 16, which is almost 50%. But the four turnovers are so huge, and that's what the really great defenses do historically. They not only make stops, they make turnovers. And I thought they needed him in this game because Trevor Lawrence just came out. He would not quit. I think all three of the interceptions, the balls were overthrown, but they were still great receptions by the Browns cornerbacks. Right. They weren't like right into their mitts. Emerson and Newsom, I think, both had to dive to the ground to make their one of theirs. So it was good to see four sacks to finally, you know, broke that sack drought up front. And home game, they do this. We got to see it return on the road once they go back to Houston in the Christmas Eve game.
Yeah, you still got to, again, the Bears game at home coming up here. Tony, it was just nice to see that the Browns kind of got back to their defensive ways. I mean, we saw those last two road games. They just didn't look the same. So do you think... I hate to just make it sound so simplistic, like, oh, they were back home, so they'll do it again against Chicago. But that's kind of what we've seen. And I know I've asked you this before, and I'm going to ask you again, though. Is there any way you can explain it?
On the road, you mean?
Yeah, the home versus road.
You know, the obvious, at least recently, they didn't have Denzel Ward in those two road games, and Miles was not 100%. So your two best players are kind of missing. Miles played through it again. I thought he had a much better game, even though he didn't have a sack, except for that 2-point conversion, which should have gone down as a sack. It was a big play. But I thought he was double and triple teamed as much as I've ever seen him. And, you know, they were fingers in his face mask and pulling him and just holding him. I think that once we get Ward back in the lineup and Garrett maybe is played through the shoulder thing, you'll see them perform better in their next road game, if that's the case.
We'll get to our three stars here in just a second, but I just kind of wanted now to look at the AFC playoff picture. And Tony, it is wild right now. And I know you given up the hopes to win the AFC North?
Well, mathematically, it's still there, but they basically have to win their last four and hope Baltimore loses two of theirs.
Yeah, okay.
Two games down with four to go. That's anyone who plays golf knows that that's a tough, tough thing. To, you know, they're almost done. But mathematically, it's still there.
Okay. Elsewhere, though, in the AFC, just in terms of the playoff picture, it's pretty wild when you look at how the wild card standings sit. Well, Dolphins play the Titans tonight for a chance to take over the number one seed again from Baltimore to both be at 10-3. The Chiefs are 8-5 as a division leader. Jags 8-5 as the division leader. Browns 8-5 as the 5 seed, the top wild card. Then the Steelers, Colts, Texans, Broncos, Bengals, Bills all tied at 7-6. So the Browns really took advantage of the opportunity yesterday. They have the full game lead, and then they have the tiebreaker over several of those teams based on either the head-to-head or the conference record. So with how it stands down, again, I'm going to keep track of this now moving forward here. best guess as to the three AFC wildcard teams that make the playoffs.
Well, the Browns, number one. I'm really worried now about Denver and Cincinnati all of a sudden again. I thought when the Browns, when Denver lost to Houston following the Browns game in Denver, when Denver lost that game, I thought that was it for them. I thought when Cincinnati lost Burrow, that was it for them. They've won two in a row. I think Cincinnati is the take everyone's quarterback away, and Cincinnati's the best team of those seven and six teams. I thought Houston was getting to that point, but what an egg they laid against the Jets. So in Pittsburgh, we know Pittsburgh is like a wad of gum. You can't shake it off the bottom of your shoe.
Yeah.
I don't know. I hazard or guess. I think Denver's got me worried. Buffalo's back in it. Chris, don't ask me that. I can't figure it out. That's why I hate being involved in the wild card, because all these things, as long at least the Browns can control their own destiny, meaning they just win and they're in.
Yeah.
The other things are just too many factors involved. I don't know. One week I think this team's great. The other week they lay an egg. So I don't even know.
All right. Fair enough. Our three stars, let's start on offense here, Tony. We do it each and every Monday following the Browns game. Offense, defense, special teams, player of the game. So let's start on offense, your star of the game.
It's got to be Joe Flacco. Hats off to David Njoku, one of his best games as a pro. Almost got to that 100-yard figure, but two big touchdowns. But
first Flacco, first multi-touchdown game for David Njoku.
Yeah, 34 and 30 yards touchdowns. But look at Flacco. It was his 100th career victory. It was his 10th career victory in Cleveland Browns Stadium. He's now 10-2. And his first victory for the Browns became the fourth quarterback to win a game for the Browns this year. He's also been nominated in this FedEx Offensive Player of the Week or Passer of the Week, one of three nominees for that. So the fact also was kind of neat that his family is – five kids and wife were able to see him play for the first time in a Browns uniform. So by far and away, it's Joe Flacco.
Yeah. On defense.
Martin Emerson, two really good interceptions deep in the Browns territory. One was about, the 15? The other one was 30 or 40-yard line. So those, even though, again, they were overthrown passes, he made a really good catch on the one, dive into the ground for it. His first two interception game. He's now leads the team with four. He also had a pass breakup and something else on the score sheet. So he had a real good game. Martin Emerson's having a solid, great year.
And the Browns special teams has been solid all year, and they were again yesterday. Your star of the game for special teams.
Well, this is a close one for once.
Yeah.
I know the coach gave the game ball to Dustin Hopkins for that 55-yard field goal. He's now 8 for 8 from 50 and up. Mm-hmm. And that was a huge kick, because if he misses that kick, you know, Jacksonville takes over at the 45-yard line, right, and they're down by 7 points. So I don't want to minimize that, but I'm going to give it again. I think it's the second week in a row for the punter, Corey Bajorquez, who had another outstanding game. And the one punt, it was announced in the press box as a 75-yard punt. It's on the score sheet as 72 yards. And the Browns punt coverage team tackled the returner after a 3-yard gain. That's a 69-yard net for a punt. Remember, that was a point where the field looked to be flipping in favor the Jaguars, and Bajorquez just moved it back. So I'm going to give it to Bajorquez. Busy day, 8 punts, average 51.5 gross and 41.5 net. So Bajorquez wins it again.
Yeah. He kicked that ball from the goal line, and it traveled. It was absolutely incredible. All right, Tone. So the Browns now sit at 8-5. Bears coming to town this week. And I'm curious your message to Browns fans, as now we are in the thick of this in terms of an AFC playoff race.
Just enjoy it. These games are so meaningful. They have a strong quarterback now leading the team. They're fun to watch. Anything can happen. I'm not counting on anything, but you got to feel the Browns have come so far through all this adversity of all these injuries that they're not going to let this slip away. So it's good that they're in control of their destiny and they're not one of those seven and six teams, because I can't figure out until the very end what's happening there. But enjoy it. These are going to be a great month of football left to go. And the finish line, we're not there yet, but I think I could see it from here.
Yeah.
Four more games.
All right, Tone, great stuff. Rest up. We will do it again tomorrow as we turn the page to the Chicago Bears. Thanks as always.
Sounds good, Chris. See you then.